Good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming. Tonight, Maria and I are really excited to have SCRAAATCH here with us. SCRAAATCH is the collaboration of two Philadelphia-based artists, we have Trichomana and E-Jane, and who are very active on their own, but in this very collaborative spirit, SCRAAATCH is their communal project. They come to us from Maryland. They have already performed and shown work at such venues as MoMA, PS1, Print Shop, and The Kitchen in New York City, and also Little Berlin in Philadelphia. So some of you might have caught that in the fall, listening to Cyborgs member Kirsten Gill has been co-curating the incubation series, and both of them were featured in that. Their work is extremely exciting. It has made a lot of Penn faculty members and graduate students rethink about how body and sound infiltrate space, how the mix and sampling can be grouped together as a kind of event of bringing very disparate entities into one single sonic space. So they'll be introducing us to a lot of their tools and leading a workshop on sampling. I'd also like to really thank them for coming because I think both of them have this really incredibly conscientious spirit. So not only in their own work, but their collaboration. They lead, organize a monthly club night at the Lock, which becomes a site for performance art, DJing, and a community event. And I also have to say that friending E-Jane on Facebook is just the most incredible thing because you witness this one person battling the dominant media cycles and just constantly working hard to present either silenced voices or different perspectives that are really outside of the media realm. So the way that they exist online and at UPenn is really fascinating for us in conversations about cyborgs, our relationship to technology, and the role of music within all this. So thank you so much, and welcome.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think I want to explain that the reason we have our setup this way partly reflects the blocking or the shape that a lot of our performances have taken in physical space, but also because we were kind of like informed about this as a workshop, like we want to have like kind of you guys be as like as a kind of involved or open and seeing kind of what's going on. So when we are demoing things, like, just kind of get up and come over.
So basically we're going to try to make a song today. It's going to be about 2 minutes long, a little bit less. We're going to use, ideally, we're going to use the microphone. We're going to make a sample online, and then we're going to like plug it in here, and I'll show you how like I normally do drum patterns through sampling, and then also play them out, and we can play it and record it and pick something that way, as I just did, played a really angry sound. And then we're gonna show how we sort of like send the information back and forth between computers and Trichomana show side, and hopefully we'll export something together by the end.
Do you want to just go into
We can do 10 minutes of that first.
Just up front, just to kind of give.
Okay.
Yeah.
So do you want me to say what you mean by production first? Or, because I just wanted to show what stems looked like first. And or we can do what you want to do. This is also our practice.
You're getting that super behind. just do it. And
okay.
We can like actually go into like, okay, this is what
I'm doing. So do you like 5 minutes of like a set?
5 minutes.
Okay. Okay.
Is it okay if we creep up a little
bit?
Yeah, this is exactly when we would want you guys to come in.
Excuse me? Charles? My name is on the list.
What?
The DJ's.
Thank you.
see the site map, all vulture loiter. Snapjaws sit in figures goiter. I play the nails, I play that hell. Ain't no good to see it. Ain't no good spell. I know we die on that cross. I walk in the evening. My heart full of blizzard. It snows on the inside. It looks like a feather. Murray descent. You try to work music. Church turn charcoal. Turn charcoal is written.
Life is getting older, life is
So that was just kind of a demo of kind of the container that a lot of what we do at SCRAAATCH like ends up in. But yeah, I guess we can now like go all the way back.
Well, we also have now we can see what samples look. So this is this is one type of sample. So I generally set it up between skits. What
program is this?
It's Ableton. Okay. This is Ableton. Yeah,
this is great.
Yes.
Can you even tell us, like, just what your setup is at some point?
No, we can go through it this slow. So, this is a Korg NanoPad 2, and so there's probably a right way to use this instrument or machine. The way I use it is basically how I used to play video games when you were a kid. If you didn't know how to play the video game, and you sort of just like mash the buttons a bunch until you kind of figured out what you were doing. So it's basically what I did with this thing, and how I, so this where it says triggered samples, they're triggered to this. And I only use this part of the drum rack because I know how to set up the channel, and I know how to plug in all 11 of the slots on this one. And it's through a drum rack, so the first thing I did was go to instrument, drums. First thing I did was go to drums and drag in a drum rack. And someone told me, like King Britt, who's a Philadelphia musician and also wrote now, told me how to do, give me a cheat sheet. So it's literally like just play video games when you're a kid. And he told me to download a drum rack and insert samples into it. And then I kind of went from there. But then I also play skits that I make to play on top of our tracks as well. We're
going to
talk about that.
Also, feel free to just like, if like,
ask
like
any
you
question.
Say something that like, wait, I don't know what that means. Just,
yeah.
What's
please
that?
Tell us.
I have a MacBook Pro. You don't need a MacBook to.
Oh, sorry. Actually, before you finish, okay. I also want to say that this pad is also connected to all of these sounds as well. And so with that, what happens is I add effects to the sounds. I insert a sound into there are a bunch of ways to do it. But basically what I started doing is taking default presets in Ableton and then inserting my own sounds and then manipulating all the presets until it sounds like something else. And then by pressing this button and like by basically turning this on, I can play it. Yes, that sound. So, just wanted to share that part too. So it works as like an instrument, as well as a triggering, as well as a way to control that.
And we'll get a chance to control it.
Yes.
So I have a laptop. on that laptop, well, I'm gonna start with the hardware. So, laptop. I control. At least live, what's going on here with a Newmark Mixtrack Pro. So it is also a controller, MIDI controller. The simple way I explain MIDI controllers is that like if you have an external mouse or an external keyboard, you also already have a MIDI controller.
Mm-hmm.
Any USB device controls. control something, it's actually a computer. It's just, you know, these are customized, they control less broadly distributed software than, like, you know, Word or the internet. So mine is like a facsimile of something that's used to manipulate songs in a DJing manner, so one song after another. But it has like kind of a host of other like effects and you know, manipulation of the speed of the song, and pretty much all the functions on here are like standard and accessible functions for the average DJ mixer, both as a digital controller as like the physical ones. Headphones, so I can cue up the upcoming track or incoming track. This is a bit new. This doodad.
We just bought it. We wanted
an
upgrade.
Yeah, the Focusrite 2-in 2-out or 2i2 is an audio interface. The previous thing we used for directing both of our sounds into one, you know, channeling through one box was a Behringer mixer that also had like capability, like a sound interface capability for like plugging in, sending digital audio out as an analog audio. And this one is like, I guess, more specialized for that job. So. And it works for us because there's like two of us, so we don't need like a guitarist, and you know, like we don't need to like send so many channels of audio out at once. But I'm still kind of like learning all the things it can do. The main thing is that this allows me to turn my digital audio workstation into the kind of like main house where all information is coming in and out, which is not something I was able to do before. And I didn't know that I needed to, so that would explain that. There's a mic that came with it. Am I missing anything? Cables. No one ever talks about cables to anyone ever.
We love cable talk.
Digital music. The cable will make or break your life. Mm-hmm. You can have the coolest, cutest set up on the planet, and if you don't have a paper, where is that bag? Like,
yeah,
this, oh my fucking, oh my freaking goodness. Yeah, just get like just a ridiculous array of every kind of adapter that you can think of, because whatever you think someone will have where you're going, they will like plan it so that they have the one thing.
Or if you're working in a group, make sure the other person knows how to do that.
That also helps. It's, we cheat because there's two of us, so we have four hands
and
two brains.
It makes life easier. But I don't know.
Yeah. So I'm actually just gonna keep this
out
at the ready. Just so I can like talk about the different inputs and outputs.
Do you want to talk about that first before we get into any making stuff? What comes before the making?
All right. So the kind of input or output that the average person is used to is like 3.5 millimeter, and that's. You know, headphones and audio jacks and all that stuff. Then we have the kind of, I guess, next common one. I already have one of these in here. If I can get that off.
Jerry better than out of here right now.
It's a quarter inch. So that's, I guess, the next up. And these two are pretty useful for DJs. That's why these type of headphones come with. They usually come with adapters, because you never know. I am really blessed to have my MIDI controller, not every DJ controller has this, has its own sound interface as well inside the system. So I'm it sounds like a lot, but basically just allows me to, it's what allows me to listen to the music that's coming out of here. So there, if you'll notice, there's no, for example, there's no information being sent out of the aux cord on the laptop, because that's analog. So that's it's like electric information instead of digital information, basically. That's a simple way. So one is ones and zeros, and the other is, how do you break down electricity? Hertz. That basically what that allows everything to do is have like a clearer signal, and there's easier way, there's more ways you can manipulate a digital signal than an analog one without a bunch of boxes and doodads, which that's no offense, obviously you guys have been getting your hands dirty with all types of analog equipment. But yeah, so the quarter inch generally plugs into those type of those like different analog devices. What else are we looking at here? This is an XLR cable. I did something that you're not supposed to do. You're supposed to turn things down for the unplugged. But so that one is a weird like little circle with three dots. On the inside, and
I turn that down. I'm just gonna turn the entire thing down.
And that is most commonly found for microphones. I'm trying to think of what other situations. I think microphones are most common.
Is that a condenser mic?
This is a condenser mic. I'm trying to think of this is cardioid.
Does that mean it needs phantom power?
It is, that's another beautiful function of this this new box we just got, is that it has phantom power. So some mics don't have, and the same thing for speakers as well. Some mics and speakers have power internally, and some of them need power from some external source. So these guys came together, so they knew that their mic would need power, and this has a 48 volt.
And I was gonna share that at home we have the stand for it too.
We did not bring the stand.
The mic stand and the and the guard also.
So there's like a pop guard that so all of your like fricative sounds. Sorry, I'm gonna get into the linguistics.
You can hear it actually.
your P's, C's, and K's.
There's an acapella we could show because you can hear it at the beginning because we didn't use the guard. The acapella, the Just the Girl acapella at the beginning, you hear all this like.
That's what I'm saying. All the, you would still hear those sounds because they're not fricatives. So like, fricatives are like P's, K's, hard C's and stuff. Things where you're projecting a large amount of air to get sound out. Basically interfere with the mic, and all the pop guard is actually like pantyhose material wrapped around the circle. No, that is, yeah. It basically diffuses that air before it hits the mic. I like these inputs because they take both quarter inch and XLR cables in one. I have been wondering why they don't just all do that, but I'm still new to this, so maybe I'll find out. I feel like I'm talking a lot about this, and I do wish someone would have when I started learning these things, but I don't want to take up too much time. Like, what am I missing? RCA cables, RCA. These are... You'll still see these a lot on like DJ mixers. I don't know how much you see them on like consumer sound systems. I couldn't say that you'll see this if you're like setting up a home sound system for sure. But I remember them. It's also the way for like analog video. Like there's like these two colors and the yellow one. Yeah, so that's the example that everyone nodded for that one, so cool. I found an example. But yeah, so like this cable, for example, turns that familiar, RCA. So this is usually how people say, oh, I can DJ the party. Like, they bring their iPhone in this cable and plug it in. So, you know, this is most people's experience DJing, which is fine. It's a lot less complicated. I'm trying to think of any other particular. Yeah, just you're most likely just going to see a bunch of different combinations of those in cable and connected form.
Software.
I am using probably the most widespread DJ software because it's the one that you can get for free.
We pay for it though. We pay.
Yeah, for it. We graduated.
We graduated.
I started off with virtual DJ free, and a lot of people do a lot of really cool things with just the free version. Entire music scene is actually virtual DJ free. I have virtual DJ pro.
You get with the paid version.
You get to use controllers.
Oh, you
so
can't use controllers.
You can't use controllers. So for the beginning of my DJ life, it was just like the trackpad.
That was both of us, because I would do all the samples on virtual DJ too.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So that was the first.
It's really
first
struggle.
We were composing.
We took that down offline, didn't we? I had to take that down. We took that down. Do we have demo of that?
I don't even know.
I'm gonna see if I can roll tape.
Yeah, so virtual DJ and for production, and, but as well as live. I do not have the dongle.
Do you have the dongle?
And I have my screen set there. And then I also use Ableton Live. I think they're on 9 right now. Or they might be a newer one. I'm using a cracked copy of Ableton 9.
There's a little bit of it. Do you want me to play some of it just to see how how much of a struggle that
was?
Sure.
Yeah. I haven't listened to it. Can
you turn me up? I don't think I'm
right. Yeah, I turned everything down.
This was a cell phone.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
We just made it seem more luxurious than it actually was.
It was not.
I didn't perform with a laptop at all.
We had one laptop. We shared a laptop.
Shared a laptop.
There was one. It wasn't even a laptop. It was a desktop that we had the screen for. We had to take the whole thing.
Okay, so
it was a MacBook Mini. Okay.
Mac Mini
that we put it in.
Phone,
like a rinky dink. It was not an iPhone. It was a bad
phone. It was like a touchscreen phone you get from 7-Eleven. It was my first touchscreen phone. And I had a drum machine app from the phone. And that's the drums that you hear.
And then we had a microphone that we were affecting somehow. And I was reading from a book.
Yeah.
We had a microphone. Because when I was reading, and this is. I don't remember
effects.
There were effects. There was something in my voice.
No, we've.
I guess there's no effect. Okay. There's no effect. This is like the very first scratch performance in a club.
Oh, yeah, this is our very first.
It embarrasses me so much. Like, if you could understand the.
Yeah, so he's reading.
Like, we're really only doing this to show you that you can start from ground zero.
Yeah, this is sampling. We're sampling.
This
right
is
now.
Sampling. Flannery O'Connor, and I just like picked a page and I would just read, and that was sampling.
So that's, okay, so this is like start.
How long ago was it?
2013, 14.
Yeah,
13. She was living closer miles several times.
Very recent.
It accelerates. The thing is with technology and the internet is that everything accelerates so quickly. And so, like, when you. Time is dilated. Like, I'm on a 24-hour cycle, so I don't even know.
You
learn so much in 24 hours.
How long is the average
human
It feels like a long time ago because of how much much material we've been learning. And also grad school accelerates things.
Yes, that was before we had fancy DAWs or audio interfaces or anything. So I'm at DAWs, Digital Audio Workstation. Ours of choice is Ableton Live because it basically lets us transition from the production side to live performance seamlessly. Can you jump between? So this side is, this is like the kind of, there's like words for these views. There's some, I'm just gonna say this is like the production side. There's like a timeline where you can like put things around. Arrangement view, arrangement. And then the other view is.
And you can drag songs, so like just to show.
The other side is clip view.
Yeah.
So this is like the killer function inside of Ableton compared to other digital audio workstations like Logic or Pro Tools and stuff is that they have this, they basically are aware that like the average electronic musician is working in small bits and samples, like building whole songs with maybe like three sounds or what have you, and they're all really tiny.
Should I pull up Auditions for a second too, just to show what that looks like? It's still useful, and I don't use it, but people can still use it, and it's very helpful, and I use it sometimes, but I don't use it as much. So as we talk about digital audio workstations for sampling and for cleaning up things, because Ableton does a lot of production work for me now, but before I did production work in Ableton, I did it in Auditions, which you can get through Creative Cloud. As you can see, I haven't used it in a while because I didn't update my version. And basically what you can do here is like in Ableton, I don't think you can convert files to different formats, but you can in Auditions. And also, like if you're just working on a sample and you want to take it somewhere else and you want to just spend some time with it, you might want to do it inside of Auditions also. And Auditions is essentially, what's the free software?
Audacity.
Auditions is Audacity. Audacity was bought by Adobe. So it's fairly intuitive. It's slightly intuitive, especially if you've used Audacity.
Is it still free?
Yes, Audacity is still free.
No, Audacity is still free.
Audacity is free.
Well, this is free.
Costs money.
Quasi-legal.
Yeah, also. But it's like my studio fees. Like Adobe, if you would need the Adobe suite, then everything is there, and so all the workstations are there, and it's like for students, I think that's like $60 a month or something, and then you have everything from Photoshop to Auditions, so it doesn't feel like that much money. It's not as much as like Ableton, per se. Ableton's very expensive.
I mean, it does a lot of things.
It does.
That's the other thing I want to say is like I feel like we do a lot of maybe like we use our equipment wrong, probably. Like I'm so glad that Eugene's not here.
Like, he'd be digging
the idea of signal processing like still means very little to me. Other than like a fancy phrase and stuff like that. But all of this stuff can do like pretty like ridiculous high end things, and I think it's fun to think that we're using like the same type of tools that people who work in sound in like very high budget situations are also using, like, you know, and there's no limitation other than like I guess knowledge or something like that, but, which is something also that, you know, YouTube is like where we're like getting on samples, checking out a lot of things. I probably watch more performance art through YouTube than I do in person. Also, it's just like probably more of, like before SoundCloud, I was listening to most music through YouTube and all that. So I'm not surprised that it has got developed entire architecture for music. For whatever reason, music people just went there. So you can always like, if you can't find something on like SoundCloud or the rest of the internet, you can literally find like some kid to like, put up their phone right in the face of whoever is performing. Like, oh, it's, I get to hear it. Like, yeah, like, I couldn't find that sample of Rachmaninoff or something. Like, I don't know anything about Rachmaninoff, so I don't know where I would start to look. But I don't think he has a SoundCloud. but I wanted to sample, and I could see, I could quickly find it on YouTube, like a million and one versions, even including one of him playing it himself. I don't know if it was a record. I guess it was a recording of him playing it. It was it starts dun, dun.
Three Nails and a Dead Man's Coffin. That's not the real title.
What? The who?
Three Nails and a Dead Man's Coffin.
Three Nails?
But that's not the real title.
Oh, is that like a like, composer joke or something?
I think so.
I don't know the joke jokes.
I don't know, but it sounds like a winner.
Yeah, but yeah, so that's the inside, the, or at least on my side. I don't use Soundflower as much as E does.
I use Sunflower a lot because mm-hmm. I'm fine with weak sound also, but sometimes if a TV show or a film is on Netflix and I really want the sound from it, I can get the best sound just using Sunflower.
So yeah, it rips sound off of something straight in
them. Yeah.
Okay. It basically tells your computer that you have.
I can show you.
Yeah, I don't know how to show
it. I can show it.
No, does it have a physical?
Yes, well, there is a physical component that can
physical.
Be shown.
So
you have to open QuickTime to really use Soundflower, and you also have to change around some settings on your computer. So the first thing I generally do is go to Sound and System Preferences, and I make it so that instead of the sound input being my internal microphone, I make it Soundflower, and then I make the output Soundflower as well. I found that if you are too loud in QuickTime, it'll actually make a reverb effect, which sounds really cool. It'll like You'll hear like the feedback and stuff. It sounds cool, but if you don't want that, you know, you have to keep the sound a certain level. So then what you do is you open a new audio recording and you make sure that the audio recording is also connected to SoundFlower. Can everyone see that?
Yeah.
And then you just record, and then you literally...
Is that in QuickTime?
Yeah. You go to File, when you open QuickTime, you go to File, New Audio Recording. Make sure that it is also set up so that Soundflower is the microphone. And then you just, whatever you want to play, you literally just to give an example, like say for instance, I don't know what video I'm going to rip right now, but yeah, right now I really want to rip this. So if I were going to rip this and I just, maybe I, like for this, you don't have to use Soundflower because you can use Off Liberty.
Yeah, so the thing with Soundflower is that it tells the computer that there's an external sound source, but it's actually just itself. so you can, any sound that would usually just come out of your speaker.
And you see how it's showing that there's sound? It's so we successfully tripped the computer because you can tell that you can see the sound being read inside
But it won't be playing out of your speakers.
So you can't audition it?
Yeah, exactly. You can't.
You have to know you want it already.
You have to, yeah. And we usually do, it's like an imprecise thing where you just like record kind of as much as you think you need and go back in and chop it up.
And I've used that to do Vines too. I've used it to record Vines and what's it, Snapchat? Anything?
Yeah.
Also,
any
sound. Any sound that we don't know how to rip, it's, do it this way.
Yeah, and when we say we know how to rip, it's like because most sources of sound on the internet are like streams that are relatively easy to exploit. Like you can, just get right to like.
Yeah, mine now.
Oh, that was like that commercial.
No, that was the beginning of The Office.
Just wanted to talk
oh, still playing.
Manager, all manager. Manager, all
manager.
Come back. Here you go. Yeah.
So some like more complex things like Netflix like make it harder for you to access like their various streams because that's their money. But like YouTube or something like that, SoundCloud has been trying really hard to like put like yet another step in front of their
for YouTube
content and stuff like that.
Just to double what you're saying with visuals.
Yeah, yeah. So like, yeah, the when YouTube is streaming, it's basically like already a little bit downloading whatever sound you're hearing. That's why, like, if your like internet cuts out or something in the middle of watching a YouTube video, you can still hear the sound. But it's like once you leave the page, it like takes it back away from your computer or something. And sites like Off Liberty just keep it. Like they just keep it. There's a bunch of these. I just put up, I think, just two examples. But this is the most reliable one, or the one that has not yet been taken down.
Pocket, Sound Pocket. Did you talk about Stream Pocket?
Stream Pocket.
You didn't talk about Stream Pocket.
It's
Stream Pocket's useful. You always have, we troubleshoot, so if
it doesn't work for Off Liberty, it's just Stream Pocket.
Yeah.
Does it rip them as MP3? Or?
It rips them as whatever it's playing at, whatever the stream is playing at, is what it gives it to you.
Well, you can also, in terms of.
Yeah, so with Off Liberty, if you put in a YouTube, I think YouTube is like, it's like bread and butter. So if you put it in, it'll give you the option to take just the sound or you want the video.
Vimeo too sometimes.
Vimeo too sometimes.
So you can make video, you can do video collage, but also sound collage in the same way, just depending on if you click this, you get the audio file or you want the video.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is a little bit how like we don't like especially E used to do a lot of like field recording work. And
no, speaking of field, so this is my field now.
Yeah, this is the field.
Rain.
Mm-hmm.
See, heavy rain. It's heavy rain sound today. Bad recording.
So this is like beyond like ripping streams from things. Freesound is like a crowdsource, or I guess, another crowdsource kind of sound platform. You know, it could be, you know, things like this from like natural or incidental sound, but it's like they also have like laser sounds or like drum kits or anything. Like, I discovered Freesound when I was looking up. But I was like, see if you can find them.
Their file. Wait,
no,
why?
No,
our
their
file
page.
Is cool. Our page is cool. It's like,
it's like the there's a DJ duo, who like we both like discovered actually separately in different times. That like I just happened to just kind of be. I was actually looking for a pirated copy of
the
EP, but so it's like, oh, like I know where they got it sound. I hear it in like a song because they have like a public profile of like all the sounds they've downloaded, and it just came up like on a Google search, and that's how I found out about Freesound. So it like legitimized it for me, in the sense that people who are already making music that I looked up to just use like this like open source kind of like. You know, it's not like they're like crafting every single sound, you know, like, and it's like proprietary. And stuff. It's like, no, it's just.
These are the sounds that we've downloaded in the past, and just sort of keeps a list. We've downloaded 67 sounds so far.
Yeah.
Irritating chorus.
What is this?
Huh?
Irritating chorus and light.
Oh, yes.
Irritating.
Wait, where's that? Right. Oh, yeah, it is irritating, but it's that sound.
So yeah,
we were doing an ASMR set, right?
Yeah, that's all over the camouflage. I think we've covered.
Are there any questions?
Yeah.
Before we go on.
For the most part.
Awesome.
Yeah, so I think I want to get you guys out of your chairs because you're really comfortable. I'm not. I won't accept that. So. I just kind of want everybody to like, come over.
So are we
going to
make a sample, or?
We can start, like, where
do you
want to
slip into groups? I mean, if we slip into groups, there can be people working on something with you, and then me and we can come together, like we do.
As always. Yeah.
Or we can just go step by step.
I'm trying to think of like a scenario where we have to make a song. Like, what would we use? We usually need to sit down and watch a movie.
Yeah, but we can also, So, okay, I think of a... So we just want to make an experimental song. No one's given us any good vibes because we don't want to worry about that. So we just want to make a song, but we don't know how to make songs. So, but we know that songs have like at least... So we know the songs have two verses at least and a chorus.
Whoa,
we've
never...
We have done that. At the beginning, we totally did. We don't do it anymore. We don't do it anymore. We used to.
There's cowbell.
Yeah, so generally, sometimes I take samples, or in the beginning I would use samples as sort of like the verses instead of using voice, and then the chorus would be some type of perpetual thing in the in-between. It's a mix between, I was really into classical music and jazz and blues and rock and roll, which is, you know, all this is an extension of blues aside from classical music, but those two have a relationship, which is jazz, so... I was coming from that perspective, and Chukuma was coming from the electronic music side, which is why we talk about these things differently. So to start making samples, I guess I think about songs as they would relate to classical compositions and also contemporary tracks. I like things that have crescendo. I like a build. I like narrative. I like you to know that the narrative is happening at the beginning, and then it's going to lead up, and then something's going to happen, and then eventually it's going to fall out. Like kind of like I also think like poetry. How poems and how that works for sampling. So we can start one sample that would be like sort of a line throughout until there's a beat, because Chukuma generally provides me with beat. Until I provide him with beat, I find signs that can go throughout, that beat can be worked with. So
okay, cool. So then I guess we'll somebody who wants to join me on on my side can kind of come through here and we can like just listen to some sounds. You're
all
kind of close.
You
got kind of close,
so. And of course, this sample that we already
so
made, because we have
it.
It's recording. I'm going to save it, because I like it. Save it.
Yeah, feel free to.
For what? What are we doing?
Just click through. Just even inside of electronic music.
This is way too fast for me.
We don't have any... It's an advantage and a disadvantage. We don't have any requirements or convention. It's not like, oh, you need a kick.
Yeah.
No, you don't really need any.
That's better.
Perfect. Slow the tempo.
Yeah. This transpose button, which is my best friend. Basically what I did was
so
the
like
sample
anything,
is being controlled down
like,
here,
and
so I took this button, which basically, it kind of affects pitch, but it affects pitch and tempo at the same time, so when I drag it, it slowed down the track, but then also deepened the voice, and then before it didn't have it so that these were sort of, I guess slave makes it so that nothing falls out of line. That's the best way I can explain it. So by clicking it and then warping the and then like using this, I can change the BPMs or the beat per minute of the track. So I'm gonna just stretch it. Sometimes I just stretch it out way out to make something else because I don't like what I initially had or I want something different.
And
this beginning is really random. sometimes when when a sample really isn't doing anything interesting, I just like cut it, duplicate it, and put it on top of itself to see what that'll make happen. So I really like this intro, so I'm gonna take some of it.
Dirty the book.
So what I just did right now is I made it so that I could adjust the fades. And so this drop-down box, it says mixer. So with the mixer, it affects the speakers and the panning and the volume right now, but if I add an effect, it'll also allow me to put automations on the effects.
So now we have a clip.
I wrote that.
I don't know how you do it.
I know. What else really sings?
So all he did just now was draw this in.
Oh my god, really?
Yeah, so there's a whole kind of sequence.
Does anyone
want
to try to? Yeah.
Awesome. I also want to learn this thing whenever.
Sure. Yeah, we can. Totally.
Does it have to be just move a monophonic line?
Okay.
Just one
so basically, I'm just trying to get something good to start with. Stretch it again.
Yeah,
or we can stretch it. We can do a bunch of things. Just any of the techniques that I've been playing around.
How do you start?
How do you start?
To play it.
Sorry. So you just hover over and you see how it makes that speaker, then you click it.
If you like the sound of so you go in here with the clip.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Switched in all of the stems and then it all went back to regular afterwards. But I have no idea how I did it. Only true point of sense that it happened and it's like, this song has 5 BPMs. And I'm like, yes, that's true. You know what I'm talking about? The Jezebel remix. You know how at the beginning the song revs up, but that's because I.
Oh, that's another cool thing that Edison does, I think, is that you can change the. You can like automate the change in BPMs for the entire song. But I never tried it, and it kind of didn't. I only knew what was happening when I looked at it, and I was like, what?
I think it's best to think about what I do is if I had a bunch of paper around me, and I was a collagist that was cutting up a bunch of things and throwing things away and adding things, but it's digital, but it feels the same way. Because afterwards, it's how'd you do that? And I'm like, I pressed a lot of buttons. that came out.
One of them.
One of them could be the one.
Yeah. I don't know if anybody wants to come up and just pick some more sounds.
But I think that's a really good way for people to sort of just get into it. You said you wanted to look at the triggered pads. Let's make a beat then, if that's the case, because we can use that. So the pad, the way it works is that all of these are triggered. I know them because I memorized them. You can put pads on them, but we can just look. So they all correspond. This is this one.
That's Whitney Houston.
It's Whitney Houston. There are a couple Whitney Houston episodes. Hold on, let me turn on this. Wendy Williams skit, and we used it for the beginning of the fader. But then I've been using it since and throwing it in a bunch of things. Really love it so much.
I mean, it's pretty impactful.
It's fading on its own.
Yes. So it the first one is about it.
Yeah.
And it fits on. Wait, that one's on. This one's on. It's an XY pad, so it does a bunch of things.
Alright, so that can go down.
It can control, like, the one I had before was about the reverb and stuff. This one's
just,
you can add effects that it can control, but then also when I do, like, I like to use it for, like, performing. Actually, what might be easier, I can show you how to, we can demo having this connect to here so that we can record what you guys play. So, yeah, if I arm this guy.
No, but I think that's for.
Input to be from.
Yeah, and you.
The master.
And within in this moment, you can overlay other.
We have the sound coming.
Yeah, you can
from
bring
here.
In. Well, you can. Sure the way that I usually do it is like.
Delete that.
Pick a different sound. So you can
pick anything. Doesn't matter. Just create like a new
Yeah.
I have
Probably really in Ableton just go file, export, and then the part I have chosen, clip. Let's see what that does and hope that it does what I want it to do. Oh, 157, yes, it worked. Let me make sure.
This,
alright, you want me to drop it in the Dropbox?
Yeah, just.
Okay, I have to go to Dropbox.
Oh, you. I don't know.
It's,
really
you know there's no
oh,
space.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so. Yeah, E is. Well, I always say E is for entropy. How many are there?
Especially when they get like
maybe.
Okay, so
right now there are three stacks.
Wouldn't you have that just finished finally?
I bought a terabyte. My desktop, my hard drive is a. My desktop is a terabyte.
No, I mean the story about this. It's not a story. It's just fantastic. The photos.
The archive. I bought a terabyte for it. What are you asking me about?
That it took 2 days to.
Oh, yes. I have this archive that I'm working on, and it's hundreds of thousands of images that I made from music videos. So I took the music videos and I exported them as JPEGs, and then I made them into an archive, and it took 2 days to import into my computer. And it feels more insane as I think about how many images are actually there. But it'll be super useful to me now that I can look at them all together.
Yeah,
that's all that matters, right?
Guys, thanks so much for this.
So I'm gonna just drag and drop this over here. So that you can find I normally do, but there's just not enough space.
Over there, so, you should come up.
Want to know what digital
what's
it called? People want for Christmas?
I'll demo that clip.
Yeah.
Don't think?
Thank
you.
There we go. There it is.
Oh, nice. I just popped
up. Awesome.
Cool.
And another way, what we also could have done, just to show you, the triggered samples are also drum racks. They can you can do drum racks in them too. So there's like this little drawing feature up here, and you can draw.
Yeah, that's what. If you came over this side, you'd have been doing chords that have that kind of thing.
And then you can.
No, no, yeah.
No, it's playing this, stop playing that.
Okay. So, I think we got it over here.
Scratch.
Kind of, we didn't talk content or philosophy or ideas at all.
We sent essays. We can talk about that if we want. Yes. The making yeah,
someone's
like,
time. I disagree
with it. Yeah, okay. So, yeah, if you guys want to do that, we can.
Yeah,
let's hear what that sounds like first. And
yeah, yeah, so that's good.
Rise back in, maybe. Is there a way to undo a little bit of take that? Well, yes, but.
so the cool thing with these clips is that you can just
stretch it back out during the
night. Yeah, with the mini clips, you can just do that. And they're, well, this is not, if it was an audio clip and you had kind of a smaller slice of it, it's still holding all the information that's there. And it's just like pulling from that information to play that small slice. And if you want a little bit more of it, you just grab.
So
it's still there.
If I just like took a slice of this and like cut it out, like these guys are, it's now just
until you tell it to make a new.
Yeah, yeah. So right now you can see how in the bottom right corner, this is the section that is. This clip is made up of now, but if I pull it farther out, it's all like still there. It works a little bit differently for the MIDI clips, but for this one I'll just copy it and paste a little bit there.
And then I'm just gonna have it so that it would rise back up, because I like that dropout, but I don't want it to stay. So. Do like that. And then maybe a lot of the stuff panning is so helpful for, or panning, and then also like just automating.
Like automation.
Automation, sorry.
Best.
See, all of a sudden we have sort of an intro.
Well, save this, because it's not saved.
Okay.
Yet. Save by set as. Listening to.
Cyborgs.
Cyborgs or something.
Our brains kind of said the same thing.
The song that you did for Chino, because it had to.
Oh.
There's that slow build
so
and then the drop.
The last song we played in our little DJ set was a remix that I did of
White Metal, yeah.
This other musician.
Don't say it.
Who we worked with a lot. I have a significantly slower computer than he, because I don't work on photo or video. But
these automations, you might have to show them. They might have to.
Yeah. So they're. That's not.
It's the song next to it, maybe. Or before it. Is that there? Go automations. Boom. Look.
Yeah.
Yay.
So,
fix this.
So there's just okay. So something that I do is.
There's some squirrely stuff going on. Just doing like a clean cut.
Yeah, I just realized like I work on certain like groups of songs together, like inside of the same environment.
We both
because
do
I,
that.
Yeah, like because I like have certain sets of sounds or like whatever. Just like I want them, the different songs to share certain elements, so it's just easier to just work on them. Together or near each other in proximity. But I think this is it.
And those automations, so yeah, track panning,
so, yeah.
Reverb, there's a reverb automation. Just maybe talk throughout the different automations that you added.
Yeah, so I don't even know what this means.
So the panning changes the ear from left to right.
Yes, from left to right. We have a mono situation
so
right
can't
now.
Really hear.
But
sorry,
no,
sorry.
No. We have sound playing.
But then also,
that's
yeah,
sure.
That is a plus.
Maybe just like click on reverb, maybe just a show of the
yeah,
reverb
yeah,
automation.
Yeah, show what's happening.
So there's reverb automation there.
Yeah, so like, for example, the, this one, by the time you get to the end of it, so that's yeah, so that one is that sound. I'm trying to think of it. Yeah, it's, I guess it's the way I usually use automation is very subtle. It's like subtle, so it's not like a. It's like that subtle compositional element where you're like constantly listening back to the same 3.5 seconds over and over and over again, and then like, oh no, that shit coming this way. Or no, it should actually echo for this many more seconds.
But that's why I have these on my neck. If anyone wants to hear depending or anything, we
can. Oh, yeah, like plug in.
Yeah.
Yeah. If, yeah.
Do you want me to?
I can. So is it three main types of automation? Reverb, panning, and the volume? Or
you can automate any
anything.
Parameter.
But I think those are the ones that they leave up.
Okay.
Yeah. So it, you can, like, for example, let me look for an instrument.
Just drop an effect on, and you can show how you can pick
yeah,
all the effects.
Like, you could like automate any of these things to come in or out anywhere.
But even less scary than that.
Oh.
Because that looks so scary. That looks scary to me.
It's just for each
instrument
independently.
Oh, okay.
Because there was
inside
that had like 40 components, so you could.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just don't get that
yeah.
Angle. So
yeah.
Maybe one day.
So we should just fade in over
time.
Hopefully
we're
no
up
to that level.
Yeah,
we'll
work up to the...
Yeah.
So now we have the... I just put like an ambience effect on one of the stems. And then you can see the device has all these different options and you can edit any of them. So let's do decay time because I guess that's something you could easily hear. Let's drop it in.
Is it solo or... Oh.
I can solo it. Do you want me
yeah,
to?
Yeah, yeah. It's going to be like really obvious.
Let's see, we turn the chorus off and on too. That doesn't end. Oh. So some of the automations fade and some of them are just hard.
Just like on or off.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, like different functions have different.
Switch it so now we're working with the echo and then
So basically every single automatable parameter here is connected to all the different parameters seeing what these like effect lights. I don't really
you
it's like
so much as like effect
yeah,
on and off
others, but, Yeah. Turning the entire effect on or off, you know. So that was what we were talking about before. And like a little red dot appears anywhere in the automation is happening. So
that was actually in use.
You see the red here.
Yeah, so if something hasn't been automated, you won't see that. So it's like a quick way to kind of know that, oh, this is where that's happening, or this is why that's happening.
And delete it and it's gone.
Yeah. Yeah, that was it. Reserve the right to post this up and play it in an international DJ mix.
Yeah, to give the workshop credit, of course.
you guys have to come up with a really cool electronic music name as your homework assignment.
So listening to Cyborgs is now cool.
Oh, I've never heard of that. I haven't heard any.
With the, you know, parentheses?
Name. Yeah, like.
With the two.
Or something. Oh, listening to the number two. You know, we're going to start getting all these emails.
Call it two for sure.
Who's listening to Cyborgs? I really want to.
It's about 18 nerds.
That's a good one, too.
Oh, yeah.
One of my favorite bands
nerds.
Is called Nerd. So.
Yeah.
That's
who we are.
Oh, see, like.
There's too much of a gap between those two.
Yeah. It all drops out.
So we can just cut out some of that empty space. Sorry.
No, no, you're fine. That's why there's two of us. He has much stronger opinions about specifics of, like.
I shouldn't drag all of that. Over
compositional
again.
Nature.
So,
another
drag all of it.
We can still have it fade. It doesn't have to jump in.
I think we need more automation. I gotta
say. It really does.
Literally
the number. Yeah. Automation is like the digital. What's this guy?
Oh my god.
I just said that to the wrong one.
No, it doesn't feel like the conductor. It feels like this. I always do that. I'm like, and then sound, and I get really into it. Yes, it does feel like that.
Is that your
good? Yeah, Bear was doing that too. Like he was doing in the 50s. Maybe he was doing the first early, you know, magnetic tape experiments. He had a device where he could pan physically to do this. That's something I came up in.
I used to listen to Tchaikovsky.
I'll try to find
I really like listening to Beethoven in his sonatas and imagining that I am telling them what to do, and then like take that ethos to here. You know, like. I think Ableton allows me to live out some of those composer fantasies that I have, and I'm grateful for that, for sure.
I mean, I always tell myself
that was going to happen. Every, like, home recording artist would have their own, like, baton that they could
have
their computer with.
But in your head it does it. You know what I mean? You feel it. Like sometimes like he's working on sounds like even that white metal track at the beginning before there wasn't enough of a build. And I was like, needs to go this and then hit. You know what I mean? He kinda like
and I literally that sound you saw that like is I snipped like the first bit of the vocals, reversed it, and then, basically played it with a really, really long reverb, recorded that, took that entire sound, and reversed it. So you're hearing what you're hearing is, like, just a reverse of, like, the first one. Like, he's like, life, like, it's like the word. backward. Like, I'm just like cheating basically, because I wouldn't know what, like, oh, let me put some violins in that, like, build up to someone saying something. But it allowed me to do that without even bringing in any other new elements. For example, like, again, just like all this, like, really, like, constant manipulation of, like, the information that I already had.
Scratch.
So, yeah.
Is there any kind of automation for anything that has to do with pitch? So can you like warp something with automation?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah, you can.
Automating
pitch?
Could, like make it pitch down or something. Or pitch it,
well, even just the bum.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's.
I mean, I know we could have done that when we were first sort of inputting that in your.
No, I think, like, I mean, it's still open, it's still there. We're still on my laptop.
Oh, yeah,
actually,
we just
switched. See? That's why it's. Don't you forget.
Those sounds, so you want to make them this Mariamba?
The Marimba. I think the maroon is the
yeah.
The vibragon is more soft.
So
you're talking about automating a pitch up or down.
Yeah.
So you probably have to like export it as an audio clip.
Yes.
Yeah. So you just like.
So in order to do that.
Oh yeah, we could also just try it on audio.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Just like slice a bit of one of those two. Just pull it down, a little bit further down or something.
Okay. And then we're gonna put an automation of like the transpose one or something. Yeah.
Yeah,
you.
I think yeah, so. It's you can turn on automation. I always forget that there's something that allows you use like hit this button and then everything becomes
is it that guy?
No, that's for following.
Okay.
Play head. But so like this is a pitch. But so if I had like okay, so there's one thing that I didn't bring in that I usually use for producing. It's just like a small. It's called a chord. No, chord. Mix key. I think it's just like a small MIDI keyboard with a couple drum pads and like a bank of dials.
Mm-hmm.
This is usually how I do it. I like put it into this mode. Where it's like highlighting these different parameters, and it just like picks up the message I would send. Like I would select one, so I'd like click this, and then while it was playing, like just play in the automation,
yeah.
And then it would be like, oh, okay.
Oh.
And that's usually how I do that. So that like otherwise I don't always know how to manipulate it like all in there. Like,
so
I'm
you
very
did that
thankful
live
for like
with
controls.
Your the dials?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm super tactile in that way.
We're both very tactile about it, which is why we also thought bringing the screens this way would be the best
way
to show.
Well, we had a short side conversation with Naomi before she had to run about watching you perform, and especially you, Yijing. I mean, it's, first of all, like there's a lot of bodily movement going on, but also like just as we even talk about using the XY pad and how like these sort of small, you know, micro movements are like actually making some strong sound, manipulation.
For sure.
Can you like speak to like sort of the tactile nature of your practice a little bit?
Yeah, Well, it's really the pad. I mean, the pad kind of, I bought a nano pad when I started working with MIDI controllers, and it's pressure sensitive. And so I think I just really got used to working with the pressure sensitive nature of the pad and allowing for it to not only give me more control, but it also allows me to, like, I guess, I want to say, the word I want to use is nuance, although it feels like the wrong word. It's like, yeah, it like makes the sound more nuanced or something, or the manipulation, so it can just, like, Shukuma,
yeah.
Can you plug me back up, please? I just want to,
you should still be plugged.
I'm not.
Oh wait,
am I?
Your screen or the audio?
The audio, is the audio plugged?
The audio should be.
Okay, cool. Yes. Never mind. I was wrong. Trying to figure out. Okay. So what I mean is like that little motion of my finger doing like on its side is like a really nuanced gesture. But like in the middle of the set, it's sort of kind of almost like a solo. To sort of be able to be so detailed about it. And then also it allows me to work around the sounds that you can just play. Or if like I want to arrange without using any automations or anything, I can start arranging just by how I work with my finger on the pad. And that's really nice. It becomes you have an ability to get like emotive about it. Like I tried to learn piano when I was a kid and never was really able to, and I always really admired how pianists would sort of like, you see them really like passionately hitting their keys, and I always wanted to do that, and I never could. But now that I have the pressure and sensitivity, it feels like sort of like that, where I can get really sensitive about it, and it can be like I can go in like a trance-like state and just sort of be playing, and it's sort of just like, yeah. It's sort of, it is like the when it becomes the most of a prosthetic, I suppose, because of the pressure sensitive nature. So it's probably the most cyborg part of my playing out loud.
Yeah, actually,
I mean, even those sounds are like, it kind of reminds me. It's almost like a queer touch or something like that. Like I don't know. It's like your hands. It's like how you would touch a lover is kind of like how you would touch the pad, and like how like if you were touching another person's body, you would understand that every little bit has like a sense or a nerve or something like that, and there's a feedback you're going to receive. It's sort of the same thing with the pad.
Or you might touch an android, that skin is sensitive, right?
Yeah.
And they turn towards you as you touch their skin, and that's what makes it an android, is the fact that the skin is acting as human skin and human sense, but it's not.
Yeah, and it's kind of soft too. I like the Android reference.
I think that's we like got a lot closer to the way that we understood like the sounds again, like the sounds that we already heard at the time. And wanted to have some direct relationship to them when we started being able to manipulate them live, like improvise with the sounds, I guess is the best way to say it. With the DJing side of it, like a song that like I understand one way can, like, you know, in a simple way, like, oh, I can just slow it down or something like that. But then like, I can like put it in the context of another song that would have usually no like relationship, no kind of like you couldn't imagine these musicians in the same room, let alone imagining them like being able to like, all right, one, two, three. Like they're not gonna like even be able to communicate with each other musically, but because for whatever reason, whatever combination of experiences I have, I like understand how they make sense with each other, so they're not like I'm like now the conductor that can help them get on the same time and stuff like that. You know, like that. That's like really abstract to say it that way.
Well, for
but
fear
yeah.
of maybe making too much
Sorry.
Of this conductor joke that we keep making.
Yeah,
you,
I don't want
to. Also,
yeah.
Ejin, you mentioned
yeah.
in the, another point to Roxana and me that, you know, the way that you're interacting with your equipment is also sometimes, like, even when you're duplicating a piece of a track, and you sort of said it's almost as if your body is carrying that sound bite until you sort of paste it somewhere else. Like, it's almost like there's this, sort of this, you know, transfer of the material through you, like you are the conductor that, you know, or the conduit of,
yeah.
of some of this. So, you know, it's, you know, how much of your body is, you know, either this conductor or both of you, of course, you know, like, how are your bodies sort of like factoring into this? Like, obviously the tactile element is very evident. I don't know, my way off base.
You mean like how like our bodies as they sort of move with the equipment?
Yeah, all of those things.
The body for me is this. Someone told me a proverb the other day where basically they someone asked the sensei, what's more important, the head or the body? And the sensei cut the person's head off, and the head fell. They cut the person that asked their person's head off, and then the person's head fell into their hands, and then the question was answered.
Really?
What was
the
sensei?
The sensei cut his head off.
Okay.
And fell into the,
basically, the point was that the body and the head are like deeply
like,
tied. So you're not helpful either way, because the body is useless without the head, and the head is useless without the body. I think that a lot of the way that I use technology in general is sort of like everyone else, like there's a part of me that daydreams about the idea that the body doesn't exist and that the machine becomes the body. And I definitely think staring at an audio workstation for a digital audio workstation is just to keep Chukuma's vocabulary on.
I don't use that word on day-to-day basis.
Totally like helps me think, like it feels that as though this is my brain, and my hand is still just connected to my brain. It's kind of like when you, if you know how to type without looking at the keys, it's kind of like as the words come out of your head, they just go onto the page, and your hand is just sort of like an intermediary. Your hand becomes like the conduit. But it's not the same thing as like the hand being the hand. It's something else that I can't quite explain because I've been typing without looking at the keys since I was 13. So I don't even 12 years later. It's a feeling where the computer literally just feels a part of you, and I think that has just extended to the way that I use the rest of the equipment and the way in which I play music. Is that like this sound? It's like coming out of my chest for me, you know?
I mean, also, dancing.
Right.
I was waiting for you to get
sorry.
No, just because like, we're producing.
Oh, yes,
yeah,
I
so,
talk about that all the time.
Can,
that's the only
like,
time that the body does
I
get
can.
Reinserted.
Yeah, like, you, the feedback, like, I have, like, a theory that a lot of, like, specifically with dance music, the reason like maybe like the discussion of it as composition isn't so primary is because it's like each song is like just like a small unit. It's not like a separate song in a way. Like it's like
inside of
it's like when you're like when you're like already like you're like you have like a song playing already, right? Yeah, it's already like there's like all these things happening, like all these different layers of like, oh, there's reference, there's like, so you're familiar with like, oh, you hear like that just like thing in there, and you're like, oh, okay, but then it's like not doing that because it's doing something else. But the way in when you're DJing, you get that feedback is people are dancing. Like, if they're like responding more, like when the, you know, the beat drops and everyone's got in there, like, okay, that's like one like feedback. It's like, I've put something out, you've been responding with your bodies, and now I have to think about what other way I might do that. And so, like,
where
then I would like maybe like play out here is like by the time like people start hearing like another thing that they might be familiar with in some way, they like well, they might have already like kind of relaxed and then they get into it like and then like start responding. But then like the goal, like your compositional element is like people self response. Not so much like, oh, I'm gonna tell you guys what I'm gonna experience. And we just have to follow.
And the production side, I think, to the more dance stuff, like when I'm making Misa tracks, I generally have a rule that like if I can't move my hips while I'm making it, it's not gonna go anywhere. So I kind of like rock in my seat as I work, and I'm just sort of constantly like this as I'm working. I'm counting a four in my head because most dance music is on a four, so it's sort of like I'm counting. Like I guess everyone else would count the eight, but I count the like you know the one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. So it's like for this one, okay, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So that's going on in my head the whole time. And when I'm at home, that's how I respond to like all the DJs and what they're doing. And that's how I stay on time with them when I'm playing live too.
I guess it's like a lot of DJs start off just like, oh, I was just a dancer, and then I wanted to hear use like, you know, I wanted to like participate and make an impact on the dance because I knew that like there's always this like conversation between like, oh, the people wanted to hear something that did this and went faster this way, but, you know, like when those like actually like. Change the overall like development of the sound through time. Like, oh, you know, like, oh, you start hearing a little bit more of this, you start hearing a lot less of that, or like a lot of like southern. There's a lot of southern like rap music right now that has like dance moves where you hit on the I guess it would be the one. So like the dab or something like that. So you have like, it's like, yeah, like, and it's like, there's even like a chant. So like, if you're not doing the dance, you still have, you can like participate at that moment. And it's like a moment where like, okay, whoever's playing the music, whoever's dancing, like everyone is participating in that musical moment. It's not just like, oh, there's an audience listening and
right.
There's someone kind of delivering sounds to them. It's like, everyone is like participating in that moment. And you just know, like whatever is happening, like, you know, people will have like a dance move where they're like, yeah, and like whatever you do, as long as you come back on that yeah, you're like still like in line.
Right. And this is also like
I love that.
Like, and this also plays out as sort of like a like it makes your hips like sometimes I do this with the hips like a winding thing, so it's like playing with the sound so that you like. And it makes more sense in the context of the dance sound
yeah,
playing with
like,
it.
Yeah, it has, yeah.
Like one time
yeah.
We played a party where there was like a cage fence and like a pole,
yeah.
And like everyone was just like running around, and you could really get it because they
yeah.
had all the everyone's just like running around dancing as the sort of industrial sounds sort of like complemented.
Then
it
comes to
ATM.
The next person yeah. to Cyborgs just has to happen at ATM.
Yeah.
It's
one
of
the
next one.
Yeah. The 24th of March, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
24th of March.
At Dallas Paradise, 4708
Baltimore. Mm-hmm. Yep. Oh,
right
around the corner.
Yep.
There you go. That's
right
down the street.
It's that's a Thursday. Yes, I think that's a Thursday. They happen actually.
We
really,
go after our rigor something.
Yeah, they happen really.
Rehearsal for a big
a lot.
Show.
Ooh.
Which
yeah.
where we're opening for you.
No worries.
Oh, that's
yeah.
gonna be so great.
Yeah,
no,
well,
yeah.
thank God you guys are doing it because we don't know what's gonna happen for the.
Well, you got some
new
tools. You
yeah.
got a sample now.
Yeah.
You know.
No, yeah, I think
some things can happen.
Yeah, we didn't talk. We didn't even. Well, we talked. We ended up talking about. Could we pull up like articles? Did anybody look at? What did we share?
I can pull up the.
I
have the
articles. Yeah.
I can show you everything
yeah.
here.
When you were talking about dancers becoming DJs, it reminded me of that Mark Ronson talk.
Oh,
I mean, I'm sure Mark Watson has his own like stories about kind of human, like. Can you pull up articles?
Which one do you want? Oh, the You mean articles like articles or articles like an article?
No, no. Yeah, our performance.
Okay.
Yeah, because we've kind of like ended up focusing a lot on like the beat driven side.
It's like intentionally absurd for the most part.
Yeah, like the improvisation is different. It's like, I'm trying to think. Like, this is where this side of it is like much more performance art than, like, it's not like based on a response that like the audience is.
It's a system that, for this one in particular, we went through a bunch of hip hop songs and we found all the articles of language, so the A, the, and then we cut them up into very finite, very small samples, and we triggered them. I triggered mine on my pad, and I think you had some triggered as well.
Yeah, I was actually using
it. Yeah, and then we sort of like played them with footage and with strobe happening. Around sort of the sirens and the more ambient sounds that I have, and it was really a sort of an absurd discussion or examination,
Like more like a meditative.
Yeah. Thinking about, because we were thinking about newspaper clippings, so it was like an absurd way to talk about newspaper clippings by talking about little articles of language, but from hip hop songs.
Like a little cutouts.
Yeah.
Yeah, so like there's like a different it's like all the same tools, but like the thing that we actually use more like tools are like specific ideas or like scores set up for different pieces. So you know, the task for this one is like, okay, find all the articles like in the lyrics for all the different songs, cut them up and kind of like spin around each other, and then like some of our other like dance oriented things have different valences, but we just we have like the DJ set as a container, like a really useful container for like all of these inclinations, because we can like in one night like at ATM we can like kind of experience like both ends of the spectrum. And like, there's not a lot of places you can do that. That's why we had to kind of start throwing ATM, like, because then like someone at ATM can come expecting pretty much anything. Like, it's not like, oh, I'm just gonna hear like a thump, like that, you know.
Do you mean to show a clip of the video from the performance that
you did?
Yeah.
Or that Misa did. Sorry.
Yes.
That Misa did. So we had.
Is Misa the name of an alter ego?
Yes.
Or not, maybe a different name for that?
Yes, that is her, that is a name for one of my alter egos. What? Okay, YouTube's acting up, and so I'm going to find it, but I'm going to find it a different way. She's an alter ego that I've been working on since the summer. And I guess, like most people with alter egos, I am weird about talking about it.
Okay, cool.
Because how do you talk about an alter ego outside of your head without sounding a little crazy? Inside of art, you just call it performance, and most people are like, that's weird, okay, cool.
Well, we are a group that is familiar with thinking about alter egos at this point. So
awesome. So I can show you a little clip. So you look all the sounds we heard. Like, this happened at ATM, and because the screen is really dark, so can you turn the lights down so that there's some more definition?
Oh, oops.
Yeah, no,
that's good. Oh, that's fine.
So, as you can see, I'm gonna go around and show what's happening. So I did it so that this is like one of the performances at ATM, and we had Misa perform the last song live as a projection while also playing it from, like, while also playing sounds, like the sounds that I showed you from the pad, alongside live as well. And then we had someone document that. And so, like, that can happen, but then there was also, like, a booty bounce set that night, like, right after that. Yeah. So, it sort of, like, varies in that way. And this is, like, I guess, like, an example of, like, how much into art you can go. Because I guess you would call this, like, more like a happening in the tradition of, like, traditional... If you can call performance art traditional, like, more traditional, in the tradition of performance art, this is, like, a happening. But then also, just, like, regular DJ set, what you think of when you think of a DJ set will also occur. I think that's enough. I just wanted to show a bit. Can you turn it off? How does the digital body factor into to this stuff?
So with the projection, with the avatar, like, is there a kind of corporeal connection with that as well? Or do you feel perhaps a greater sense of alienation with it?
So, like, sort of like talking about avatars for me started from thinking about chat rooms when I was a kid and the avatars that you literally use to be inside of the chat room, and then also how we use the avatars as like the... photographic icon that identifies us on a lot of social media platforms. And I was thinking about how people are sort of reduced to this image. And so rather than denying the reduction, embracing and revving it up a bit. So like I was working a lot with avatars that way, like thinking about this, like what we think. Like a lot of it, I'm really into like Octavia Butler and a lot of science fiction novels and like fantasy. And so a lot of it was sort of like me creating, I guess, my own fantasy or science fiction scenarios where thinking that instead of like just sitting complacently, my photographic avatar ran amok behind my back and or like with my knowledge and just
fantastic.
Sort of started to hang out online by themselves and talk to people. And so it was the idea of like separating them from my body and letting them run off, and like this idea that there was another form of me somewhere hidden that could not sort of that is not necessarily like they are alienated in the way that I think like Siri is a deeply sad, like I think Siri is super sad. I think I once asked Siri like if Siri could fall in love, and they said like I'm only here to serve you, and that just really hurt my feelings. Like no, I don't want to subjugate you, Siri. You know, but I think those entities are really sad. Like I think Black Mirror had an episode about like an avatar, like, or it was like a clone, like a mind. Martine Rothblatt really is thinking about mind clones, but Black Mirror also an episode where this person got this surgery that extracted their memory and made them into a little teeny. I don't know if it's a holographic version of yourself,
like
or it looks like
a Siri.
Or it looks like the avatar ran away. It like literally looks like the avatar just like, you know, like got up detached from you and like now does things for you inside your house. But it's like a smart home device. And so their second self, even though they're completely conscientious and feels like them, is just their smart home and is really tortured
the
whole time. It's really sad.
The horror element in there is that the Siri version of the person thinks that they are the person and has to like
clean up after the person's toast.
It doesn't start off that like
okay.
That way. They're like where the fuck am I, like
yeah.
Where am I in this infinite white space with just like this desk, and how do I get out, and like the operating system inside of the device is like telling her like, okay, this is what you actually are, like you're just a program, and
your job is to like do these things for like the you, the real you that's out there. And she like spends like several weeks very dissatisfied with that, but because she's just a computer program, like the program just like
SimSurf, fast forwards
her
life
years and weeks,
and it's torturous.
She's, like, kind of broken down.
Yeah.
After you know, this is like seconds in time of like someone turning it on for the first time, and just saying like, oh hey, what's up? It's me. Can you go like you know, turn on the lights when I come home or something? And by that time, she's like, okay, like sure, like, yeah. But that was,
So the avatar was quite sad. It was quite like a very dark joke that I was having with myself, and that I, all that work is sort of like me and dark humor and fantasy and science fiction. And then Misa, on the other hand, is sort of like my superhero that I've been also it still stems in sort of writing, but like there's like this like self map that I draw up. So like she has attributes and characteristics and like only comes out in certain times, and there are all these rules that I've like sketched up in a sketchbook for her, and then I just try to like breathe life into those ideas through different parts of media and different happenings where she emerges in space. But
this started at ATM.
Yes.
Yeah.
She did.
To say,
Mm-hmm. So yeah, so she's, I mean, that it's corporeal. It's almost like, I always joke that like when I look on my Instagram page, it's like me and her are sisters, but she's the more popular sister, and like everyone thinks about her more anyway, you know, and like she's like more femme than me. Like there are all these ways in which she and I are just like slightly different and working from different parts of my, almost like I've given her a reign over like a small portion of my brain. It's like, okay, you get to make decisions from this place. It's like the place that will allow me to embrace things like lace if I want, but also to yell at people if I want to. And I mean, it's, you know, it's probably the most, like, you know, like most superheroes, I think they have the right to be more unruly than everyone else. And also a superhero that wants to be also a pop star is just sort of like, you know, they're like my 17-year-old me's hero, kind of. Yeah. And she is corporeal as well. But also thinking about The Wizard of Oz, which I've always been really inspired by. Like, I started using this phrase, both the projection and the black woman behind the curtain, because I was thinking a lot about how people don't understand when they look at media on the internet that there's a person behind a screen that might be a dweeb, and then there's all the things that they can sort of create and project out into the world, just like The Wizard of Oz. Like it's the exact sort of same story where he seems so big and powerful from this, like, it's literally like a projected, if you watch the movie from the, with Judy Garland in it, you, like, when they go to see the wizard, and he's like kind of, it's like this projected giant head, and it's like talking at you, and it seems so intense, and then they go behind, it's just like this man, like this, and I always imagine that when I'm at my computer, I'm kind of like that, like, you know.
That's how they look.
Yeah. Yeah, that posture, and I'm just like, that'll be a smart thing to say. Say that, and it's like, you know, saying things that, because we imagine if someone uses all caps, you think they're yelling. If they use all under caps, you think they're whispering. So it's like, if you know what I mean. So like, you can communicate a lot through the internet in ways that maybe your voice can't even communicate. Like maybe you're not actually capable, but you can perform this capability through technology, which pop stars already do. I mean, like. It's like I'm stealing techniques that I kind of already, like, you know, there's like one step to understand the media is manipulating us. There's no step to go, well, how are they manipulating us? And there's no step to go, okay, well then, how can I use any of those tactics to also make things that I want into reality that are fantasy? Because that's what you know, popular culture essentially does, is makes a bunch of things that are just fantasy seem like reality. So does that answer your question?
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Yeah, thank you for sharing.
No.
Yeah, I think sound is definitely sound is definitely like that for me. Like there are so many things I can't say, do, play, I doubt that I'll ever get, not only do I doubt that I'll ever get the chance to control like an orchestra's worth of instruments in physical space, but also historically when I see electronic musicians finally get their chance to interact with the orchestra, it's usually underwhelming. But if I want to do that, I can do it in a very particular way here that even the actual orchestra can't do. Like, they have like human hands and, you know, instruments made of like matter. And so, like, it's like, oh, if you play that fast, the violin's gonna catch on fire. Like, you know, like, there's like these limitations that kind of like disappear when you can just manipulate like digital information and stuff like that. Like, I just really like. Like, that's the thing.
But also both in terms of the body, very sickly bubble children, like in terms of humans, like we can't withstand very intense like weather or like just a lot. So like the technology I think really allows us to exist productively and like usefully to society.
Yeah, I have a lot of friends if you come to internet in person.
It's like so bad that I had to do a project last year in photography where we had to do landscapes and I went on Google Maps. Like, it's like screenshots. I like worked with them and they were pretty images, but
yeah.
If I don't have to leave my house. Yeah.
And I think I mean beyond like the whole like the joke side of it, I think in a lot of ways, like everything that we're dealing with here, like this whole history of sampling, you know, electronic music, like starting like someone like making a mistake with technology, like using it wrong, like someone used the turntable wrong, like some teenager like fucked up his parents, like, you know, like turntable when they were home, and then said like, oh wait, I can do this other thing, but then like you got into like the idea of like the break being like the interesting part of this you know. It's like a full-on song with all these other parts to it, but the break was the part that like everyone out in the, you know, party, the block party or whatever, like really started, like their bodies responded to it, almost to like a level of like I mean not control, but control, like you could like manipulate how people are responding. I mean, you can see this like now in like a really extreme way when you go to a rave, but just like, oh, the idea of the break being isolated and looped for longer and longer and longer, and becoming the song, right? It essentially was because like, there's something that it did to bodies, and then that did something to the sound, and that did something to the technology that you had to have. You know, you had to develop technology that like now then like fostered that type of composing. That was like, yeah, you know, like the story of the break is like the story of like composing electronic music, and of course it's going in a million and one different directions now. But that's always like really exciting to think that, you know, versus like the kind of like genius narratives of a lot of like music where it's like, oh, like, you know, God like opened up the sky one day, like, showed me like the birds, and then I decided I wanted to write, you know, Rhapsody and blah 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 or whatever. You know, like,
Rhapsody in Blue? Or are you just like?
I mean, you know, whatever. Yeah, I'm just kind of like, I actually don't know.
Okay.
but yeah, like I like that idea of this kind of collective, like brain, like deciding, kind of, you know, like the sound just kind of being a outpouring of like this like relationship between like different groups of people and interacting and stuff like that. That is just like very exciting to me, and again, like I don't think there's like I would have like a lot of ideas outside of that. So it's exciting that there's a place or an environment, like a critical environment, a whole that I can have a job with there's a whole infrastructure for like a place where it's like, oh, I, you know, there's this like funny meme that everyone already thinks it's funny, like. It would probably be exciting to dance to that funny meme. And like, oh, there's this like structure of like beat patterns that people are familiar with that get people dancing. Like, oh, but like, I, you know, obviously I should just put
our friend Jem.
No.
We're gonna have a Jem remix.
No,
but
I was gonna say the there's a song that he made, like a
the
remix.
Jocelyn Hernandez.
Yeah, and it was like the elements are like okay, Rihanna.
An acapella.
Acapella.
I made like a soundscape.
Yeah, a bunch of different sounds.
One of which was like pouring water in the sound of Serena Williams playing tennis.
Like just like the building up, accumulating of all these samples that like people already have like a response or connection to, and then Joseline Hernandez, who's
Real Housewives.
Real Housewives of Atlanta. She's and like just like okay, if you put these in a blender, what happens? And like people respond to that, like wow, that makes sense. But it was like somebody tweeted
vine of Joseline Hernandez in the booth, like a studio booth. Doing this like verse or something, or this like chant or something, and someone said this should be the final verse on Bitch But I Have My Money, the Rihanna song, and I was just sitting at my desk, and so I was like done. Sunflower, made the loop in Sunflower, just recorded it for like 2 minutes, took it, dropped it over the track, arranged it a little bit, and it was, it just worked really well.
So it's like it was an idea, and now it's
that was a Misa track, of course, because everyone's screaming.
It's a really noisy one, but it's like, it's not like, oh, this is a world craft. I mean, craft to some extent has to, like, you have to be able to, like, put these things.
You have to be able to cleanly sample the loop, cleanly add the loop. I mean, there's things that has to,
But it doesn't become, like massive.
No.
Like, it's like, oh, like, someone's going to respond to this because they have, like, they already have a relationship. A bunch of the elements that you're presenting them. But I think that happens a bunch in all types of music. Like, I was like looking somewhere. Somewhere it's
well,
like,
jazz,
it's
I
like
mean,
music is like music, like the only, like some researcher, like a team of researchers realized or concluded that the only thing that makes music is that you feel like you know what's coming next. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing meter structure, but it, I'm sorry, the elements of music, notes, tonality, and what have you, aren't the, that none of that makes music, but it's the fact that you feel like you know what's coming next.
It's like in a Billie Holiday song, if like a phrase from Rhapsody in Blue were to be played, you would like hear it and be like, for anyone that knows like those jazz references, and you kind of just like hear the, it's like in a solo, it's like you hear the horn do it for a minute, and then you're like, oh, I know this, and I know what this is from, and you feel the sense of it, and maybe you think of a high rise, and then it kind of goes back to the song.
Same thing with Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Same thing. Or that's, you're exploring the same human response. Maybe.
And the same joy that you're going to get. Or like in 12 Bar, I think like there are a lot of guitar, like blues riffs that are used in like several guitar blues songs, like Manish Boy, like the riff from that is like used so many different ways throughout the history of the blues. But every time you hear it, you kind of know what it is, you know what it sounds like, you know the lineage of it, and so you're like excited for the whole story you have in your head as you hear that riff. I guess that's how like some people feel about samples or like the beginning, like
I'm just gonna sit here.
It's also 9, so if you guys that was helpful, then
we can
stop.
Are you two available for a drink, for a beer? Maybe we help you wrap up, and
awesome.
Then we'll continue the conversation. Everyone's welcome. We'll go to White Dog.
Cool. Sounds good.
Yes.
Cool.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool.